Namaskar. I welcome you all for this journey of Mumbai Local. In fact, even a thought of traveling in Mumbai Local nowadays fills me with dread. But today I am full of excitement and happiness traveling in this Mumbai Local. And I would like all of you to travel with me today. Nobody is going to be on the platform. I think it's because of this lovely organizing team of Edgar we can be so comfortable here. Thank you very much to Mumbai Local team. Today I'm going to speak about dance and beyond. In fact, speaking about dance itself is very challenging. It's like describing a movement of a sea wave. And talking about dance and beyond is like diving in a deep sea with a danger of drowning. But I'm sure with all of you, this lovely audience, I'll be saved of drowning. Dance. Since I'm an economist also, being a postgraduate in economics, I always look at things from micro point of view and macro point of view. So today, I'm going to begin with the dance. When we say dance, first thing comes to our mind is it's a emotional exuberance. It's a celebration of your happiness, your festival. Sometimes it's a celebration of your victory. But for me, dance only is not only the exuberance of happiness or a means to celebrate a festival or a mode to earn profit. But for me, dance is something beyond. It is a process of evolution. It is a structure processing of body movements. To comprehend the life energy within. And I have experienced this throughout my dancing career. Career is not a nice word here, but with a lack of any other word, I should say career. But throughout my dancing life, I have experienced this. When I started dancing, I don't remember. But I remember my mother telling me that when I was a child, any music played, I would start dancing on it. Coming from a non-dancing family, I have no dance lineage. This was very surprising. So I always feel it was the call of the soul which attracted me towards my art. Belonging to an academic family. For me, dance class was a gift for me for scoring distinction in matriculation. And I had to continue with that type of distinction in academics to learn dance. There was a class very close to my house, which was a Bharatanatyam dance class, and I started learning Bharatanatyam there. Those were the days where there was no Google. So we hardly knew anything about all other dance styles. And that was the nearest place, and I started learning dance. I was very lucky. I got a very good guru in Guru Mani, learning Bharatanatyam there. And first year only, there was a ballet and I got a lead role in the ballet. And first time my family came to see me. when they saw me performing, they realized this is something beautiful and nice, because my whole family never knew anything about dance. My father would come to drop me at the dance class thinking that it's a very good exercise, and he never saw what I was doing inside. Then later on, after 2-3 years, my Guruji came home and he told my parents that she can do her Arangetram. They heard the word Arangetram for the first time, and my Guruji had to explain to them what Arangetram is. But with full enthusiasm, my family supported me and we did a very good Arangetram, not only from the organizational point of view, but I think I performed well, because everybody said this was like a performance, not a Arangetram. So that's how my dance started. Those days in India, there were 7 different classical dance styles. I never knew about any other dance style but Bharatanatyam. Just imagine how ignorant we were those days. And now these young children, they know so much about everything thanks to the information technology. And after my Arangetram, I wanted to learn from a very big Bharatanatyam guru who was very popular in Mumbai. And with all enthusiasm and the appreciation which I got after my Arangetram, I went to him and I asked him, can you teach me? So he said, no. Your start is itself wrong. Whatever you have learned is wrong, and I can't correct you now. You can never become dancer. My dream was shattered. I mean, I could not imagine, after so much of appreciation after my Arangetram, that somebody is telling me that whatever you have done is all wrong and you can't dance. But in life, they always say, when one door closes, another opens. Maybe the one more door was to open for me and he rejected me. I came back disappointed and told my Guruji what happened to me. And my Guruji was such a humble and nice person, Guru Mani of Kalasadhan. He told me, don't worry. He was a Pandurang Bhakt, so he told me, Pandurang will show you the way. And that was a time, as I said, it was a time of revival, and television has just begun, and we had no television at home also. Whatever programs, sometimes I used to do some TV programs, small little kids playing, khel khilone and all. My whole family would go to neighbor's house and see that. And I saw Guru Kelo Charan Mahapatra performing. I was wonderstruck. And I told my Bharatanatyam Guruji, I want to learn this dance. And see, imagine those days, gurus were so broad-minded. One day when Guruji was taking workshop at NCPA, Guru Mani informed me that there's a workshop by Guru Kelochan Mahapatra. If you want, you go and join him. See, the one door was closed, but I think not a door, but gate was open for me. I went to Guruji. And Guruji was very happy because I was a trained Bharatanatyam dancer. He used to be very happy to when the dancers come to learn from him. So he told Guru Ma, see how beautiful she is. I was elated. And later on I realized that he tells that about every dancer. Because he was a person who used to see beauty in everything. Beauty in every moment, beauty in everybody. So he told me, first day he never let me sit in the class to watch the workshop. He said, come on, start dancing. And that's how I started learning Odissi. And that was the time when Odissi was revived, and in India we had this nationalist feeling about our dance styles. Because now also whenever we go out, very recently, last week only I went to Venezuela, and there people thought I'm from Orissa because I'm doing Odissi dance. They said, you're from Orissa? I said, no, I'm from Mumbai. So they said, how come you're learning Odissi? So I said, that is the beauty of our country, that we can learn any dance style from North Indian person can learn South Indian dance style. That is the unity of our country. So I started learning from Guru Keluchan Mahapatra. And I don't have to tell you all about Guruji. Everybody knows about him. And I was awestruck with all his choreographies and compositions. So I could never think of creating something of my own. Because we are so awestruck. And I used to enjoy Guruji's choreography so much. It was like a very comfortable zone. If you want, I can show you just a beautiful example of Guruji's choreography. You would like to see?
Yes.
So this is a beautiful Ashtapadi of Guruji, which Guruji used to perform. And I'm just doing it. Maybe 1% of what he used to do, I will be able to do it here. But this Ashtapati portrays Radha and Krishna. Now here Radha, after her union with Krishna, tells him to decorate her body once again with sandalwood paste. She asks him to put kohol in her eyes, make her hair, and make her pure and beautiful once again for that union. And this whole poetry is allegory of this love between human soul and absolute. And the uniqueness of Guruji's choreography, I feel, is that whenever you look at his choreographies, you don't get only involved in the symbolism, but you can enter the real meaning of the poetry comes out in his choreographies. So I will just perform this small little piece of Guruji's choreography.
Hridaya Nandane.
How Guruji's choreography used to be. The most erotic theme, but so beautifully presented. And Guruji's teaching style was also different. It was like improvisation every moment. Once I remember he was teaching us Shiva Panchakshara Stuti. And for one description of Shiva, he kept on giving us different poses, about 50 poses, and we had to remember. And then he will keep one. And there was no limitation of time. He will never look at the watch while teaching. It used to be sometimes very late in the night because ours was the, I think, last batch who learned in a Gurukul pattern of learning. So we used to live in Guruji's house. Once it happened that it went on and on and on till 1:30, and everybody was very tired, sleepy. I was trying to hide behind somebody so that Guruji doesn't look at me. But he had that third eye. He just pointed out, come here, he called me. And then he just looked at me and lifted my chin, and then he said, Tumhara aankh laal ho gaya hai. He called everybody. Dekho, isne beer piya hai. So that's how he used to make the learning and whole class very lively. And we used, later on, he was like our friend, philosopher and guide. And that is the same teaching tradition we are trying to continue. So coming out of Guruji's greatness, not coming out of, but you know, doing your own things, I was very conscious about it. For me, it was very difficult even to think of doing something new. And one day I called Guruji home for dinner, and I thought I must make Oriya preparation for Guruji. So I made Oriya type fish curry for him. He used to love non-veg eating, and he just started eating, and he said, ye to fusion ho gaya Marathi aur Oriya ka, because maybe it was a flop recipe. He said, ye to fusion ho gaya, aisa kuch dance mein karo. That triggered. Coming from Guruji, that you do something like this in dance. And then I started thinking what I can do. So I started searching for different poetries. I went through Sant Gnaneshwar's literature, and I started working on Viranyas of Sant Gnaneshwar, because I could find some similarity there of Ashtapadis and Viranyas. The same longing of human soul to meet the Absolute is there in Sant Gnaneshwar, his literature also. He describes the Tribhang, this body position which is there in Odissi. In Gnaneshwar's literature, I could read that Tribhangi Dehuda, Thana Mandunya. The Tribhangi Krishna is standing. That's how he described Lord Krishna in Gnaneshwari. So I could find some similarities, and then with less confident, but I decided I'll do something new, and then I started my own choreographies. Now while doing that, when we do our own choreography, we have to be very careful. And for that, I always take inspiration from sea. Whenever I look at sea, I am enamored not only by the continuous flow and movements of sea waves, but I also look at the way it restricts itself from the sea line. If it breaks the sea line, it loses its beauty and creates destruction. So in my choreographies, I always feel I should get this inspiration, that within that framework, I will try to create beauty. So that was one phase. And then there are so many unfortunate things happen in our life, everybody's life. I also went through a series of disastrous events in my life. I went through a very bad marriage breakup, and those were the days. It's like, you know, it's like Amrit Manthan. The whole emotional turmoil has to come out in some form, and I started writing. Initially, it was just Marathi poetry writings. I used to write and hide it from everybody, just to just keep it aside. And those days, I read lovely poetry book, Kanupriya, of Dr. Dharmavir Bharti, and so inspired by that poetry. I wanted to do something about Kanupriya, but you know, something or other happened and I could not do. But it was always there in my mind. And then another disaster struck in my life. That was, I was performing in London and I was so unwell, but still I kept on performing. Somehow after winding up the tour, I came back to India and immediately went to the doctor. They said, you have a 8 to 10 inches big tumor in your abdomen. I said, but I'm fine, I have absolutely no pain. Yesterday I was performing in London. He was shocked. He said, I can't believe this. I said, yes, but I have absolutely no pain. Just imagine if there is some stone here of 8 to 10 inches big, I can identify. But something which is in my body, I never knew. See the extent to which we ignore our body signals. It's not that I was not getting body signals. All of us, we get those signals, but we are either less sensitive about it or we ignore. And then I was asked to be admitted in a hospital and get all the tests done for surgery. And I was very scared because I had a performance after 15 days. So all the time I was telling my doctor, no, I want to perform after 15 days. Please, you postpone the surgery. So they said, we can't postpone because it's a big tumor. In any case, you can't dance with this tumor. And after surgery on 15 day also, you can't dance. So I could not accept that. And luckily, my doctor also was a lady. Ladies are more dynamic, I think. I'm sorry. So she said, let's give it a try. At least maybe just to pacify me, she must have said that so I can go through the whole thing very happily that I'm going to perform after 15 days. And after my surgery, she gave me extra proteins, everything. I could not sit down. I had to perform. I have Kaushik ji here today. He played for that performance which I performed on 15th day of my surgery, and all these musicians, everybody was very cooperative. My family, I mean, I must thank God how many times, I don't know, to get such a lovely family. And all the musicians, they're like a family members. So I used to sleep, lie down on sofa, and they would rehearse in front of me, deciding how many avartans will take, which item we are going to perform. Kaushik ji used to tease me, okay, so we'll have a sofa on the stage also. And then I performed at Nehru Center on 15th day of my surgery. When I came back in the wings, my doctor was standing there, my mother, everybody was overwhelmed. And I was also overwhelmed, but I thought, why am I doing this? Why did I perform? I mean, there was no money involved. There was no great number of audience. It wasn't like thousands of people sitting and watching you. Then why? But I realized it was just to, you know, release that life energy in me. Just to surrender to that life energy in me that I had to perform. And I thank my family, my doctors, friends, everybody to give me that courage to perform on that day. So I always tell everybody, whenever you see anybody struggling in life like this, if we give encouragement, it will be so beneficial to that person. Then, till then, I never knew that it was, what was it, the tumor. They had sent it for test culture, and it involved what you call culture test. When the reports came, we found out that it was a malignant tumor. So then the whole cancer treatment started, chemotherapy, radiation, everything for 6 months. But luckily for me, after every chemo cycle, somehow I used to get some performance. And those were the days I used to hide from everybody what I'm going through, because I was scared that I won't get a performance if I tell people that I'm going through cancer treatment. So whenever there's a call for performance, I would arrange it in such a way that it falls on the third week of my chemotherapy, so I'm all right and I can perform. I had no hair, no eyebrows, no eyelashes. My mother, very innovative mother I've got, she made a lovely wig for me. But wig, where will I tie it? I can't even clip, there's no hair. Then she made a thread with which I could tie wig with to my ears, and then I would perform. So all those, throughout the treatment, I perform. And I feel that this determination that after every cycle I have to perform used to bring me back to normalcy. Usually, you know, if you see somebody taking a chemotherapy treatment, people don't have appetite, they don't eat anything. But I used to see to it that I eat because I have to perform. And those days I used to hide all these things from everybody. After the treatment, I was all right. I started again performing, growing my hair back and all those things. And one fine day, there was a cancer patient with whom I shared these things. She was a very close friend of mine. And she told me that when you shared all these things with me, I became so positive towards my treatment. See, it's not that you don't have to take doctor's treatment. That treatment is always, you have to go through it. But your attitude, you become more positive towards it. So that's how this art form helped me. In many cases, it may not be dance, it may be something else. In fact, for later on, I realized it was more difficult for a dancer. Because for a dancer, you have to look beautiful. You have to physically be very strong. You have to be very sharp intellectually, because you have to remember all the things which we are doing on performing on stage. At the same time, your mind should be at peace. But I never had all these three things when I was performing. But the only thing which kept me going was this desire to not to give up and to, you know, not to reject this life energy. And when I shared the whole thing with this friend of mine and she started responding well to her treatment, I decided I have to share it with everyone. So I started little bit of counseling for cancer. I wrote a book on cancer, not directly, but about my own experience, and a production showing the story of a cancer survivor. And that time, Mr. Gangaram Gawankar, a very famous playwright of Marathi theatre, is here today, and he encouraged me to write a book in Marathi. So I've written a book, Mayur Pankh, in Marathi, about this whole experience and how my art has helped me. And I feel everybody, if you are working in an office, that work also can help you. So it is your passion for whatever you are doing will help. This is, I'm telling you not as advice, or I feel that I'm in a position to give you advice, but only because I've gone through this. And then I decided I have to do something different now. And I remembered Kanupriya, but that book was not available. Now where will I find Kanupriya? I went to the library from where I had taken that book. So they said, no, somebody has taken away that book and they have not returned. So again, I was disappointed. And suddenly a phone call comes to me and that person tells me, are you Shubhadaji? I said, yes. And he tells me, I have got this book for you. I said, but who are you? So he said, I met you in that exhibition. We had one exhibition at Churchgate Theatre for one NGO for which I used to work, for underprivileged children. There were so many books, and this gentleman who was working as a motorman in Western Railways just passed by the stall and he asked me for a book. So I told him, no, we don't keep such books. In fact, I am also searching for Kanupriya. I'm not getting. I just shared casually with him and he told me, okay, give me your number if I travel every day to Delhi in Rajdhani, because he was a motorman of Western Railway. So I will try if I can get you. And this, after 7-8 months, he is calling me and he is telling me that I have got this book. But still I was little skeptical, you know, we women, anybody calling. And so he said, where do you stay? I said, I Goregaon. Again, I thought, my God, he's going to come home or what. So then he said, can you do one thing? At 12:42 on the platform number 1 at Goregaon station, if you can stand there, I will give you this book. And I hurriedly I took a rickshaw, because you know, station, there's no parking. I went there and I was standing at the platform number 1 of Goregaon station. This man comes out from the motor, not out, just his hand comes out from the motorman's cabin and he tells me, this is your book. Before I could ask him, I asked him how much money, and before I could take out the money, stain started. He said, no, I don't want money. When you do something, you call me. I was about to take his number, but I could not take. And that's how I got this book, Kanupriya. So it was intense desire maybe in me to do something. I said, now I have to do something. Now when I present this new production, after this whole turmoil of my treatment, I thought I must do something different. And nowhere our scriptures mention that you can't do something different. There is a story about Bharata and Shiva. There is a legend that Bharata Muni, when he wrote Natya Shastra, he took a play to show it to Lord Shiva with hundreds of his sons. I think it was 100 actors. Those days, directors used to consider their actors as their son. I don't know. What is it now? So all he after the play, Shiva said, yes, this play was very nice, but where is my dance in this? So Bharata had to include dance in that, and thus in Natya Shastra we have dance. And then Shiva also thought that where is Natya in my dance, so included Natya in dance. So thus, and making our classical dancers life more difficult because now we have to enact certain poetry, which you saw today, and with the help of all the stylistic body movements, body hand gestures, facial expressions, like Natya Shastra has so many facets for dance, like they have various hand gestures are mentioned, like pataka, tripataka, ardha pataka, kartari mukha, mayura, ardha chandra, rala, shukatunda, mushti, shikhara, kapita, katakamukha, suchi, chandrakala, padmakosha, etc., etc. With its usage also mentioned in Natya Shastra. So within this framework, we have to do something. And then I thought, we never do vachika abhinaya when we dance. So now Lord Shiva has given the permission to include different elements, so why not me including Vachika Abhinaya in my this new production? And in Kanupriya, I have done dance and narrating of the poetry together on stage. So should I show a small little piece from Kanupriya? Where now this Kanupriya, I was enamored because this Radha, usually when we say Krishna, it is like a lovely child, handsome adolescent Krishna who broke so many hearts in Vrindavana, then King Krishna, King Maker Krishna. But here Radha is questioning that Krishna about his war. So that boldness I loved in this poetry. It made it something different. She questions him. She asks him that us din mere tumhare paita ne agar Duryodhan hota to. So that questioning mind was very alluring to me, and Thus, I went for this production with the help of my team of musicians full-fledgedly. So I'll just show you a little part of Kanupriya here, where the scene is Kalia Mardan, small little piece, and then Radha says, this is me only. She's Shakti. If you are Purusha, I'm Shakti. So that part of Kanupriya I'm showing you. When dialogue starts, on hi rakhne ko. अकस्मात लगा कि मेरे अंग अंग से ज्योति फूटी पड़ रही है। तुम्हारी शक्ति तो मैं ही हूं, तुम्हारा संगम, तुम्हारी योग माया इस निखिल कारावार में ही पर्याप्त है। विराट सीमा ही अगम दुर्दान, पर जब मुझे चेत हुआ तो मैंने पाया कि हाय ये सीमा कैसी, मैं तो वो हूँ जिसे दिग्वधु कहते हैं, काल अवधु, समय और दिशाओं की सीमाहीन पगडंडियों पर अनंत काल से अनंत दिशाओं में तुम्हारे साथ साथ चलते चली आ रही हूँ, चलते चली जाऊंगी। इस यात्रा का आदि ना तो तुम्हें स्मरण है ना मुझे, और अंत तो इस यात्रा का है ही नहीं मेरे सब यात्री। सुनो मेरे प्यार, ये काल की अनंत पगडंडी पर अपनी अनथक यात्रा तय करते हुए सूरज और चंद्र बहते उधे अंदर गरजते हुए महासागर, झकोरों में नाचती हुई पत्तियां, और चांदनी में सरकती हुई नदियां, इनका अंतिम अर्थ आखिर है क्या? केवल तुम्हारी इच्छा, और वो क्या केवल तुम्हारा संकल्प है जो धरती में सौंदापन बनकर व्याप्त है, जो जड़ों में रस बनकर खींचता है, कोपलों में फूटता है, पत्तों में हरियाता है, फूलों में खिलता है, फलों में गदरा। यदि सारे सृजन विनाश प्रवाह और अविराम जीवन प्रक्रिया का अर्थ केवल तुम्हारी इच्छा है, तुम्हारा संकल्प, तो जरा ये तो बताओ मेरी इच्छा में, तुम्हारी इस इच्छा का, इस संकल्प का अर्थ कौन है? कौन है वो जिसकी खोज में तुमने काल के अनंत पगडंडी पर सूरज और चांद को भेज रखा है? कौन है वो जिसके लिए तुमने महासागर की उत्तार भुजाएं फैला दी है? और कौन है वो जिसकी आत्मा को तुमने फूल की तरह खोल दिया है? और कौन है जिसे नदियों जैसे तरल घुमाव दे दे तुमने तरंग मालाओं की तरह अपने कंठ में वक्ष पर कलाइयों में लपेट लिया है? वो मैं हूँ मेरे प्रियतम, वो मैं हूँ। With this, I tried to do something with this poetry with the help of Vachika Abhinaya on stage. Now, there was another phase where I realized all these days I never used to take interest in teaching dance. It was like only performing. Never realized that if my Guruji had not taught me, what would I have done? So at this point, I started teaching little more seriously and started my dance classes along with my book writing. And I realized that while teaching, you learn so many things. It was again learning process for me. Teaching my students Guruji's composition, making new compositions of my own. And again, after coming out of all these difficult times in my life, here I realized that again I am in that protective zone of creation. I have to come out of it. Most of our choreographies were either based on mythological stories of Krishna, Shiva. I did one production, Prakriti Nartan, which was about nature. But still, the movements which I used to use in my dance, like we have a proper grammar, all of you know, of classical dance. So when we show Krishna, we show it like this in Odissi. Maybe Kathak will show like this or like this, but this is Krishna. And with that reference, I have one hand gesture to show Krishna. So many hand gestures to Krishna, the most popular amongst dancers. Then Shiva also I can show. But if I take something which is purely philosophical, there's no hand gesture which is written in the scriptures for this. How do I present the philosophy? And I took up Swami Vivekananda's philosophy of Vedanta and tried to explore the dance movements here. Although I never wanted to break the framework of our classical dance style, I kept the flow as we have it in any Odissi dance recital, like it begins with Mangalacharan, then pure dance, then Abhinay, and ultimately it is Moksha. That also I experimented. And then I wanted to do something from Rabindranath Tagore's literature and Gangaram Gawandkar ji is here. Today I'm very lucky to have such a lovely, or Satya ji is there, Gangaram Gawandkar ji is here. So it's such a beautiful audience today. So when I wanted to do something in Marathi, he readily accepted it and he wrote a play, proper play in Marathi. And I tried to use it like how we have Sangeeta Natak in Marathi. Like that we did a Sangeeta Nritya with Odissi dance and Marathi play. Now here, I had experimented with Vachika Abhinay in Kanupriya. But here there is another person acting with me, which was so difficult. Because we classical dancers, we are so free, we feel we rule the stage. We can't share it with anyone else. And here, I had to actually communicate along with another actor on stage. And we had some of the most well-known actors from Marathi stage acting with me. And first day I was so nervous, I could not even deliver any dialogue. Because with such senior artists, and we are not used to looking at another actor and talking on stage. Our hero is somewhere there. So I experimented with that, and I think to some extent he will also agree that it was successful. It was a dance and proper play. Now in this whole process, when I experimented with Swami Vivekananda's philosophy, I realized that it's so difficult. Like when Guruji used to perform, he used to transform himself. When he used to do Radha on stage, he would look like real Radha on stage. So that transformation was very important. And that only creates the rasa. And it's a rare moment for any artist. Once I remember, I was performing Jatayu Moksha. It was open air place. And that day somehow everything went on perfectly. Perfect music, perfect lighting. Singer was singing very well. Everything was perfect. And I enjoyed the performance. I was totally involved in it. When I came back, I was sitting in the green room. One lady came with her daughter and told me that she wants to see Ram in Jatayu Moksha. I do all the characters, Ram, Lakshman, Sita, Jatayu. It's a complete piece in itself. So she's telling she wants to see Ram and she's after me. So I got her in the green room. I'm just standing with the same costume, same makeup. That small little girl looks at me and says, "No, this is not that Ram." So the moment when I was on stage, I was feeling like Ram. She was also feeling same thing. So that connection with Rasika, anything to become successful, any performance to become successful, the most important thing is Rasikas. And when you have such a lovely audience with that blank canvas, like that small little child, you get that moment, that magical moment of performance, which rarely happens. And thus I always feel whether the performance is small or big, whether it is paid or unpaid, I have to do it with full sincerity, because you never know when I'll experience that moment again. So that type of transformation I was looking out for when I did Swami Vivekananda's production. All these productions, I tried to use little bit of levels, little bit of theatrical elements in my productions. As I said in the beginning also, this journey, I don't want to take alone. I don't want you all to sit on the platform. I want you all to join me in this journey. So if you have any question or anything, you can ask me. You feel there are no inhibitions. You can ask me anything. No? Oh. So Edgar is looking at me. So is it? Yes. So I was sharing some of these beautiful moments in my life when I perform, whether it is in India or abroad. And whenever I perform abroad, I felt the Indians there, they say, no, we don't understand classical dance. I don't know why. But the foreigners or the locals there, they love Indian classical dance. And I feel that is the most important aspect of our culture, our country. I always feel that to create is great, which we are all artists are doing. To preserve it's greater, and to propagate is greatest. And if we can do all the three things together, this we can preserve this rich cultural heritage of our country. But that doesn't mean culture is a flowing thing. It never stops. It should never stop anywhere. It has to be open for new things, new ideas. But as I said in the beginning also, with that boundary, not to cross that boundary, that is what I mean, I do myself. Every artist, every human being has different idea about creativity. My idea of creativity is this, that I will stick to that framework and do innovations within that framework, which is sometimes very difficult. You know, we artists, we love freedom. And why to restrict ourselves? But with freedom comes responsibility also. And most of my production, I have tried to do that. Now, when I did...
Does it mean that the framework is finite?
Sorry?
Does it mean that the framework is finite? And will never
change?
So when you do innovations within the framework,
But those innovations are infinite. I mean, you can do as many, like there are seven surs, Sare Gama Pa Dhani. So within the seven surs, you know, these classical artists, what they do, they create whole raga and they can just go on and on. So, or everybody has their own framework. Like I'm a Odissi dancer, I have my own framework. Maybe Bharatanatyam dancer has a different framework. So we work within that. If I want to break and I can take little bit of Bharatanatyam, little bit of Kathak, little bit of folk and make something, that is also possible. That is every artist's choice. But my personal feeling is that if, actually in my life also, at a point of time I used to do both the dance styles. I was a Bharatanatyam dancer. I had learned from Guru Mani of Kalasadhan, properly did my Arangitram. I used to teach my Guruji in the class. And then later on I started Odissi. I used to perform both the styles. And I realized that when you're performing, you have to be more spontaneous. You can teach two dance styles. But when you're performing, in that spontaneity, there is a chance that you mix two dance styles. Like when I had to unlearn so many things. Like when we do Bharatanatyam, we walk like this one, two. The whole style is very bold. Whereas when I started Odissi, even the walk is different. And when I perform this on stage with spontaneity, there is a chance that I will mix these two styles. And that's why I had to choose between these two styles. Of course, I loved Bharatanatyam. It's not that this is better or that is better. Both the styles are great. But this became my personal choice and I started doing only Odissi. So that framework is, for me, it is finite. But within that, there are infinite possibilities. Then when I did...
I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
You mentioned Arangetram.
Arangetram.
Would you tell me what it is?
Yeah, good. My family was not the only one who never knew about what Arangetram is. So that is the performance we do after completion of our training. It's not the end, but it's the beginning of your dance career. When you complete your training from your guru, guru gives you that, gives you ghungroos, and then you can perform wherever you want as a professional dancer, or you can teach. We have in Odissi Mancha Pravesh. After completion of training, guru gives you permission to do Mancha Pravesh. It can be a small little affair with few people, family people. The most, it need not be a grand affair in a big auditorium with dinner and all, but it can be a small little. But most important thing is you should be ready as a dancer to perform Arangetram or Mancha Pravesh. Yes, in Arangetram there is an order, whatever you learn, like in Bharatanatyam we have Alari, Pujadisharam, Varnam, and in Odissi Mancha Pravesh we have Mangalacharan, Bhattu, Pallavi, Abhinay, and Moksh. So, and the whole recital, see the idea of classical dance recital, Odissi recital is symbolic of this evolution of human soul in this body. It begins with Mangalacharan. Mangalacharan is an germination of this soul in this body. The second comes Bhattu, which is pure dance. That is the purification of this body where the soul is going to evolve. Then third is Pallavi. Pallavi literally means to elaborate. Movements are lyrical and graceful with equal importance to rhythm and music. So in Pallavi, this soul blossoms. And then in Abhinay, where you we present a theme or a poetry, in Abhinay it matures, and then ultimately at the end in Moksh it reunites with the Absolute. So that's how the recital is designed, and that way we perform in Mancha Pravesh or Arangetram.
Excuse me, Arangetram is after how many years?
Oh, this is a question all my students' parents, they ask me. Yes, actually for me, this is my feeling, that I don't keep any limit that you can do Arangetram after 5 years, 10 years, 3 years, 2 years. It depends on a child, how much he or she can receive it. Because nowadays it is very difficult with their other commitments.
Yeah.
These children, they have so many classes, and then, but still I feel if child is very sharp and very sincere, you can do it in within few years.
Yes.
And if it is not, then you can never do also. So yes. Anything?
Yeah. At the back.
What is the connection between an artist and the audience? And what do you find today's audience, do they have the capacity and patience after, you know, their attention span decreasing? Does it satisfy the artist, you know, today's audience?
Today's audience is exceptional. I'm so happy because all of you are... This is a lovely audience I have got today. I'm so thankful to you and to everyone that it's such a lovely feeling to be here. But as you said, what is the connection between artist and audience? Rasikas. Actually, the success of the performance depends more on the audience. It's the energy from you all which we drive. We take your energy and we perform. If there is no audience, there's no performance. So it has, it's not only one way, but it's reciprocal. And as I told, I gave you one example of how that magical moment happens only when we have good audience. And am I missing anything from your question?
Audience, no, but no. Generally,
how
know,
is
people,
the audience nowadays?
Do they allow the artist to mature to her performance and, you know, enjoy and give that reciprocation?
That's a very good question. Sometimes nowadays, I don't know whether it's audience or organizers, but once they call us, they said, no, we just want 20 minutes, half an hour. I mean, for a classical dancers, we have given our life for this divine art form. We have been trained so much to put up a performance, and you know, it is, as I said, it is a symbol of evolution of human soul. So within 10 minutes, we have to show that. And but whenever we perform, everybody is like, you know, oh, we wanted to see more. So I think we need more opportunities for audience to see it so that they understand the classical dance style. I don't blame this young generation because they have no opportunity to see classical dance. If you switch on the television, what you see? There's no classical dance. You don't have to use your own thought process to understand those dances. You can just sit and watch. But here you have to imagine certain things because the dance styles are so stylistic. Nothing is given directly. You have to imagine things. Once I was working with a German choreographer in Germany with Western classical dancers and live German music orchestra playing for us. He asked me, can we lift you? I was taken aback. What is this he's asking? You know, like those Western dancers, he wanted to lift and do some act. So I said, no, you can't even touch us. So then I explained to him, you do the action of lifting me, I'll do the reaction to it. And then I explained to him our aesthetic theory of our dance, where certain things are left for imagination, and our hand gestures. In our dance styles, we use every minor and major limb. So they were enamored by our ancient technique, and this was written in Natyashastra. So I feel that we need to educate the audience, or educate in the sense you have to give them more opportunities to see it. So, anyone else? So, when a classical dancer performs, yeah, sure.
I don't have any questions, but only to say thank you for the lovely speech that you have given. And I have learned lots of things. It's the way you present yourself, you keep your smile. And among all this, I see my son who never concentrated on anything except books when he gets. But he's the one who came here, saw your show, he's listening to the book. Doesn't distract him. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure. Pleasure is mine. She said it very nicely. No distraction. Actually, whenever I was working on this journey to divinity, I felt that our mind distresses emptiness or vacuum. Always there is desire or aversion towards something. It is said that it is like a tree on which two monkeys are sitting, aversion and desire. And until and unless they don't stop agitating, there is no peace. And when there is peace, then something beautiful emerges. And that's what I found when I did this piece from Vedanta. And now I think all the questions are over. I will just conclude with this small little piece from Vedanta, which shows that how we can internalize our energies and not get distracted by anything else. Of course, we artists have this habit of feeling bad about criticism, feeling very happy about praises. That is very natural. I'm also like that. I don't know when I'm going to come out of these emotional turmoils, but I think that's what all of us must try to do. So, can I show the last piece and conclude?
Yes, please.
Thank you.
च श्रोत्रजीवे न च घ्राण नेत्रे न च व्योम भूमिर् न तेजो न वायुः चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं 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 न मे द्वेष रागो न मे लोभ मोहो मदो नैव मे नैव मात्सर्य भावः न मे द्वेष रागो न मे लोभ मोहो मदो नैव मे नैव मात्सर्य भावः न धर्मो न चार्थो न कामो न मोक्षः चिदानन्दरूपः शिवो 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 मृत्युर्शङ्का न मे जातिभेदः पिता नैव मे नैव माता न जन्म न मे मृत्युर्शङ्का न मे जातिभेदः पिता नैव मे नैव माता न जन्म न बन्धुर्न मित्रं गुरुर्नैव शिष्यः चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं 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 अहं निर्विकल्पो निराकाररूपो अहं निर्विकल्पो निराकाररूपो विभुर्व्याप सर्वत्र सर्व इन्द्रियाणां सदा मे समत्वं न मुक्तिर्न बन्धः चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं चिदानन्दरूपः शिवो
of the universe. Please join us at MQ library at 5 p.m. on 2nd of December. do leave your name and email address at the counter. We have Priyanka there. Thank you so much and have a nice weekend.
Thank you.